meow, 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 because your geek history lesson on cheetah is now in session. Meow. Hello and welcome to Geek History Lesson. I'm Ashley Victoria Robinson.
And I'm Jason Hairball Inman. Welcome to your mind university, because this is Geek History Lesson, the podcast where we take one character, one team, or one movie and teach you all about it in a little bit less than an hour. And today's episode is about Cheetah. No, not the animal. The DC Comics supervillain.
Still the same spelling.
Fair,
thanks, DC
fair.
Comics, for making research difficult.
Fair. Oh, the Google was like all over the place?
Yeah, like I put in cheetah, and then you know what I got? Pictures of cheetahs, which was great, but unhelpful.
They were like a cat-like creature that stalks the plains of Africa.
Yeah, an apex predator. The fastest land animal.
Well, we are talking about cheetah. And all the various kinds of cheetahs in DC Comics because of there might be a movie that you might have heard of that came out very recently called Wonder Woman 1984.
Yes.
And we're talking about Cheetah 2020.
Yes.
Yes. So, Ashley, I know we have some listeners that suggested this episode. Who are they?
So the TAs for this episode are Vicky Fox Martin, Joshua Van Dyne, and Tom Hibbert. By the way, special shout out to Vicky Fox Martin, who requested this, I think, during our first year of the podcast. So hope you are, I think you're still listening. I think you see you on the Facebook. But Thank you for your patience.
I was going to say Vicky Fox, just well done on being sort of an animal-like creature that would be similar, I think would be a friend of a cheetah.
Excellent, excellent name. And the thing that is cool about the TAs is that they are fans who help shape the show. And if you are a fan who wants to help shape other creative things that we're doing, Mr. Jason Inman has a very exciting special something coming to Kickstarter
that I think
you should all know about.
Yes, I have a new comic book written by myself with art by George Kamenbaya. He is a very lovely Greek artist. And his name is quite difficult for me, but it's quite beautiful as well. It's Kamenbaya. And he draws amazing art. He's done all kinds of great books. And we are launching a book called Super Best Friend, which is about Maddie Moore, the best friend and sidekick to the world's greatest superhero, Captain Terrific. Think Superman. And Maddie Moore has a YouTube channel where he broadcasts all the adventures of Captain Terrific. And this comic book is about the hijinks of what happens when Maddie Moore live streams the wrong things about Captain Terrific out into the world and what happens there. It is a 48-page comic book that we'll be launching over at Kickstarter on January 19th. So the easiest way to follow it is to go over to my Kickstarter. Go to Kickstarter, search for Jason Inman. You can find that by searching the old projects like Jupiter Jet and Science, and you can click to be notified when the project goes live. We have a lot of great things, a lot of amazing variant covers. And if everyone that listens to this podcast donated a dollar, I would fund in seconds.
Yeah, really.
That's honestly, because we're not, you know, we're just literally asking for the cost of the comic book and hopefully make more. We want to make more Super Best Friend because this is an ongoing tale. So if you've ever wanted to know about what my thoughts about Superman and my thoughts about Jimmy Olsen would be, go over, check out my Kickstarter, Super Best Friend, January 19th, 2021.
There you go. Now, back to Cheetah, who is not a hero, but a villain. Let's move right into the 10-cent origin, the first part of the podcast. Mr. Jason Inman, what's the 10-cent origin?
The 10-cent origin, whereas Ashley's going to tell you the basic tenets that you need to know, the cliff notes, if you will, of Cheetah. And they're going to be especially helpful if you're
Warning.
Ever...
Oh. Self-destruct sequence has been initiated.
Oh, no!
Wow, I think the...
4 minutes, 55 seconds.
I think the soundboard has some opinions about Cheetah.
This is going to be a short episode. Oh, boy! I didn't realize the soundboard didn't... like 10-cent origins.
She don't stand, Cheetah.
By the way, we should put it out to the listeners that if they want to name the GHL soundboard.
Sure.
Tweet at GHL Podcast. We'll give the soundboard a name.
Yeah, there you go.
If you want to. I mean, I like computer.
No.
But that's just me. Anyways, the 10-cent origin is a Cliff Notes version of everything you need to know about Cheetah. In case you're going to a Legion of Doom cocktail party, Lex Luthor stops by and says, "Have you heard of this new member named Cheetah?" That way you can answer him and he won't kill you on the spot.
So we're going to start in true GHL fashion with a giant caveat. So
also an Ashley Lesson favorite, the caveat.
There are actually four women who have taken up the mantle of Cheetah. So for the sake of this episode, for clarity, we are focusing on Barbara Ann Minerva, who is the third Cheetah, who appears in the film Wonder Woman 1984. That seemed like the best way to do this. If we had done all four, I would be here for hours. So if you want to hear any of the others, you can request those separately, and we will absolutely add those to the list. So Cheetah is a DC Comics character. It is debatable whether she's a villain or an anti-hero. If you are like me, the opposite of a hero is a villain. She's a villain. She was created by Len Wein and George Perez, two of our faves here on the podcast. And her first appearance was in Wonder Woman Volume 2, Number 7, in August of 1987.
She's a very recent
character. She would not have existed in 1984 when the movie is set. Her name is Dr.
That's fine.
It's completely fine. Her name is Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva. She is an English archaeologist who is empowered by the plant god Orus Kartarga. If that is the incorrect pronunciation, I don't want to know. It's made up. She is a Wonder Woman villain, but she's also Wonder Woman's friend, which is kind of where you get into that gray area of how villainous she really is. Her team affiliations include the Legion of Doom, the Injustice Society, the Suicide Squad, the Secret Society of Supervillains, and the Injustice League. And her abilities include super strength, endurance, speed, agility, reflexes, senses, and hand-to-hand combat, cheetah physiology, and appearing as an anthropomorphized cheetah, which I didn't know was a superpower.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
In terms of her abilities, because superhuman strength is a very generic term.
Yes.
Based on your research, where would you place Cheetah's strength?
And she's strong enough to subdue Wonder Woman in a headlock.
That's pretty strong.
So I would say she's up there with Wonder Woman, Superman.
So she's not going to punch planets, but like she could catch like a jet if she wanted to.
Yeah, she could definitely like rip a human's arm off.
She could fight a tank.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah.
All right. That's pretty strong.
She is portrayed in Justice League, the animated series, by Cheryl Lee Ralph. And as a Broadway fan, Cheryl Lee Ralph is one of the original Dreamgirls. I think that's pretty.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. That's like, I was like, oh my God, that's so amazing.
Oh, that's cool.
And in DC Superhero Girl, she is voiced by Ashley Eckstein.
Hi!
Who we all know from the Star Wars franchise. The DC Superhero Girls design, by the way, is one of my favorite DC Superhero Girls redesign of this character. I have the Barbie doll. It's so cute. And of course, she is famously portrayed in live action by Kristen Wiig in Wonder Woman 1984. And so that is your 10-cent origin on Cheetah. And we're going to move into the meet cute, which is the second part of the podcast where we talk about how we first meeted the character and how cute it was because we stole a term from romantic comedy writing. For me, the answer is duh to longtime GHL listeners. I first met her in Justice League, the animated series.
I was going to say the answer cannot be Batman, the animated
series. Voiced by Cheryl Lee Ralph. She's amazing. I actually think Justice League, the animated series does a really, really good job at condensing down a really weird, complicated character. I like their version of Cheetah a lot, the way that they slim it down. And I think the episode I probably saw her in was Injustice for All. And that's like the first time the Injustice League all gets together. It's a great episode. I always thought she had a cool design because I love cats. So I always thought Cheetah looked cool,
which she always has.
Even when it was a lady in a suit, she's always looked really cool. Yep. So Jason, what is your meet cute for Miss Barbara Ann Minerva?
I do not remember.
That's fine.
Exactly. I know that I read a Wonder Woman comic book in the mid-90s that was the same volume as the George Perez run.
Went on for a long time.
Yeah, so like I know it was like in the 80s or the 90s or like the 120s. It's somewhere in there. And I believe it was when Brian Bolland, classic artist of The Killing Joke.
Ah, the French bikini Wonder Woman costume.
Yes, and he also drew that famous cover of Wonder Woman where she's like standing with the spear with all the Greek objects that Sideshow made into a statue.
Yes.
Somewhere in that series of comic books, she fights Cheetah.
Yeah.
And I remember reading that issue and just being like, oh, who is this cat lady? Now, unfortunately, when Grant Morrison, a couple years later, did the Injustice League, he put Cersei as Wonder Woman's big bad, not Cheetah. So, to be honest with you, I haven't read that many Cheetah stories.
It's sort of debatable, I think, in canon, whether Cheetah or Cersei is Wonder Woman's...
Who would you say? I weirdly would say Aries, even though it's I don't
but
like
that's not, a modern thing.
I know.
I would probably say, Cersei.
That's a George Perez thing.
I would probably say Cersei personally.
Yeah.
She's not as exciting from like a filmic point of view. I understand why they went with Cheetah for the movie.
I agree.
More about that later. I just think in terms of like going toe to toe, I think Cersei's a cooler pull because I also think Cersei's a more interesting figure just in terms of the Greek mythological Odysseus.
I always thought, you know, I'm throwing this out to the world, but if I was writing Wonder Woman, I would, I've always thought it was weird that they didn't make Artemis, the 90s hard ass Amazon, a bad guy.
Ooh, that's a good call.
Yep.
Artemis is cool, by the way, and
Artemis is cool.
Has not had her
due. The ginger Wonder Woman.
Yeah, very pretty. All right. Enough about Artemis. That's another lesson.
Yes, now we need to go into the History 101, the main meat of the discussion, where Professor Ashley will open up her tombs, or her tomes, excuse me, not tomes.
Why, not both? Maybe, she's an archaeologist. Why not both?
Maybe she found her tomes inside the tombs.
There you go.
And they're all dusty. She will blow the dust out of it, away from the students so you don't cough, but she will tell you the secrets within about Cheetah.
So, fun fact, this is not the first time we've talked about Cheetah or specifically the Barbara and Minerva version of Cheetah on Geek History Lesson.
Okay.
We talked about her in episode 52, Flash Rogues War Review.
Oh!
So you can go check that out for nostalgic purposes if you like.
By the way, I want to point out to all the listeners as well that if there was ever an episode to wear your leopard print clothing, this is the one.
This is the one. I'm looking at you, Victoria Malle.
Oh, boy.
she loves a leopard print. Right. The first cheetah, we're going to run them all down really quick. The first cheetah was Priscilla Rich, who we met in the Golden Age.
That's a great name.
A literal woman in a cheetah costume. Then her younger, sexier niece with a smaller, sexier costume named Deborah Debbie Domain took over as Cheetah. Then the Golden Age, the Silver Age, and the Bronze Age all roll around into the late 80s, where two of the most prolific comic creators of all time give us Dr. Barbara and Minerva, who we are going to talk about today. Her family holds an ancient seat in Nottinghamshire, which I have never heard of before, but I'm sure...
Is that a real place?
It is a real place.
Okay.
But I am sure all of our English listeners are going to laugh at me for my pronunciation thereof. Barbara is described as, quote, ambitious, selfish, and severely neurotic, end quote, which I think is a bit harsh.
Yeah.
If she were a man, she would have been called Driven or alternatively Batman. So, like, Cheetah's not a character that I am emotionally invested in, but they do her so dirty at so many points. So we have a lot to talk about in this lesson.
Cool.
Dr. Minerva's drive and passion leads her to finance an expedition to Africa in order to study a tribe supposedly protected by a female guardian who is imbued with the powers of a god and specifically with cheetah powers. So during this expedition, this female guardian is killed. So Dr. Minerva and a character named Chuma, who is the local shaman of the tribe, do their best to try and restore the power balance. Luckily, Chuma is a shaman who works with the god figure Urskartaga. Jason, you familiar with Urskartaga?
Not at all.
Urskartaga is an ancient plant god who basically only exists to make Cheetah Cheetah. Not real. Completely fictional.
Not in any mythology.
Universe. No, completely fictional.
Oh, so this is a George Perez creation?
Yes.
You said Len Wein as well, right?
Yes, Len Wein.
Okay, cool.
Working with Chuma and feeling guilty over the death of the female guardian, Dr. Minerva pledges herself to Urskartaga in order to become the new guardian and take up the role and protect the tribe. So this includes a ceremony, right? Where she's going to ingest part of Urskartaga, which is a plant. So she's just eating a plant or drinking some tea, whatever.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Mixed together with human blood, berries, leaves, and this will gain her immortality. But it also gives her orange skin, black spots, a tail, claws, superhuman senses, and reflexes, which are not necessarily something that was supposed to come along with that. And however, it is explained because patriarchy that the cheetah guardian had to be a virgin in order to become the true guardian. And because Dr. Minerva was not a virgin, her powers manifest as a curse, leaving her in constant physical pain and physical disability when she's in her human body versus the anthropomorphic cheetah body.
And she feels fine when she's a cheetah, but she hurts if she's a human.
Yes, but when she's in her cheetah form, she has bloodlust and the urge to murder people. So I would like to take a minute here to scream about the myth and that the power of virginity is worth anything and state that it is so ugly to say that a grown woman has to be a virgin and to use her sexuality against her like that. I like the Cheetah character, and I think this is a, by modern standards, a gross misstep of her creation. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk.
I only have one thing to say.
Thank you. I didn't want to dwell on it too long, but when I was reading these original, like, it's so ugly the way this is handed down.
Ashley, I don't know about you, but when I read DC Comics, I especially want all my characters to grapple with virginity.
Yes, and morality they're surrounding.
Also for our
parents. She is a grown-up. She is a woman in her 30s.
Also for our parents that listen to this with their younger listeners.
You're welcome.
I apologize for that car ride.
But now you get to have a really meaningful conversation.
That's fair. I agree with everything you just said.
Thank you. But now that the lesson is back on track, let's talk about how Cheetah and Wonder Woman first cross paths. So Diana Prince comes onto Dr. Minerva's radar because the good doctor is searching for an ancient artifact. Jason, which ancient artifact do you think she's looking for?
Can I get a clue?
It's something Wonder Woman has.
Oh,
obviously.
I'm going to guess the Lasso of Hestia.
That is a great at the time called the Lasso of Truth.
Okay.
But yes, that is, she's looking for the Lasso of Truth, aka the Lasso of Hestia. That's actually, the renaming is a modern construct.
I know, it's a retcon, yeah.
Which I'm fine with.
I think it's a Greg Rucka retcon.
I believe
so. I could be wrong about that.
Dr. Minerva wants to add the Lasso to her private collection, which isn't even a particularly original motivation for being a Wonder Woman villain, but it's also not like the worst one of all time, so we'll just let it pass. Like,
they
always want either the gauntlets or the Lasso.
Also very similar to Indiana Jones of, it belongs in a museum.
Truly. And rather than, you know, calmly approaching Diana and professionally requesting to study it, Dr. Minerva tries to trick Diana into giving it to her for keepsies. And it works a little bit, but she is unable to hold the lasso in her bare hand. Because, Jason, what is the result of holding the lasso?
Well, it compels you to, like, feel the truth or be your true self or... You know, like, yeah, bad people can't touch it. They hurt.
Yes. So
basically,
when Dr. Minerva holds it in her hands, she admits to Wonder Woman that she is trying to steal it from her.
Oh, fair. Yeah.
And so Diana's like really upset by this treachery. So she takes the lasso and flees the room in tears. Very dignified.
Oh, because she thought
they were friends.
She thought they were friends.
Yeah, it breaks her little heart.
What?
Breaks her little Amazon heart.
I wonder if that happens a lot to Wonder Woman. Like, if Wonder Woman's dating and people come over to her apartment and they accidentally touch the lasso, like, what's this? And the guy's like, I just wanted a one-night stand.
Yeah, yes. I don't think they would say it that eloquently, but yes.
And Wonder Woman's like, ah.
Nah. I like the version of Diana where she just punches them through a wall. And
yeah, she kicks them out the window. Yeah. You're probably right. You're exactly right.
So when trickery...
Landlord is just like, Diana, come on.
He's
again?
Like, again? He just puts up drywall. He's not even putting up real walls at this point.
Listen, Diana, it's Victor, your landlord.
I live in an embassy.
Well, I'm the guy who up. Look. Okay, I'm
you're Ferdinand, the Minotaur. Who
no, I'm Victor. I'm Victor. And I'm the groundskeeper.
Sure.
I'm also the handyman.
Yeah.
Sometimes I teach orphans chess in the basement, but most of the time, I'm plugging in your holes for these men you keep kicking out the wall. You gotta stop it.
And I gotta date more women.
Yeah, there's only so many bricks in this country, Diana.
I don't know if that's true.
There's only so many.
Okay.
They're valuable.
Okay.
Bricks.
Reclaimed bricks.
Yeah.
So when trickery doesn't work, Dr. Minerva escalates to violence almost immediately because comic books, and because she has the handy-dandy ability to turn into a cheetah monster of incredible power. So I'm not saying I wouldn't do it, but it definitely makes it more convenient. Over the years, Cheetah and Wonder Woman fight over the lasso specifically. It's for about 5 years before the Cheetah persona overtakes the Dr. Minerva persona, and she becomes more focused on just defeating Wonder Woman in battle and overpowering her rather than procuring a specific artifact or accomplishing a task.
So they turn her into sort of the Hulk.
Basically,
yeah,
for a while.
Yeah, where she goes mindless for a while.
It's kind of up to the discretion of the artist
and
the writer, whether or not she's stuck in that form, if she can change back, if it's painful, how often she can do it for. Yeah, it's kind of like a Scarlet Witch power.
I know we're not very far into this lesson, but what do you prefer from your research? Like, what do you like it that she's always cheetah? Do you like that she can flip-flop? Do you like the bloodlust? What's your favorite
version? I like it better when she's stuck in the cheetah form.
Permanently.
Yes, I think it gives you more to grapple with narratively.
Okay.
And if I were in charge of a cheetah story, I would want to start there and maybe get to the point where she could shift back and forth.
Okay.
I just think it gives you more to play with, and it gives you more like monster Frankenstein of it all.
Sure. Okay.
So cheetah loses pretty much every time. And her ego, as well as her body, grow increasingly bruised over the years, and thus a supervillain is born.
Yeah.
Now, Jason, I have an important DC Comics geography question for you.
Oh, boy.
Have you ever heard of the fake DC Comics country of Pan-Balgravia?
Actually, no.
I hadn't heard of it until doing research for this episode. I think it only exists in this one storyline I'm going to talk about.
Pan-Balgravia?
Pan, like Peter. And Balgravia, kind of like a Scandal Inn, but spelled differently.
Pan Balgravia, its mountains are so fine. They love to drink all kinds of turpentine.
Oh, bringing turpentine back. That's a joke for only me.
Yep.
What's important about this country is that this is where Cheetah and Wonder Woman's relationship begin to change. It is during yet another fight in these most hallowed of grounds that Wonder Woman saves Cheetah's life for the first time.
Okay.
So I'll tell you how this happens. Varin von Nostrade, who's the leader of Pan-Balgravia.
Yes, that famous character.
Yes. Great name, but a great villain name.
Sure.
Has Dr. Minerva kidnapped and held captive in order to serve as a metahuman vessel for the demon Drax. Drax has a wife named Baramargux. I'm going with that. So TLDR, Wonder Woman travels all the way to wherever Pan-Balgravia is supposed to be and saves Cheetah from being locked away in a demon dimension or possibly another world. It's not really clear. Forever and ever, amen. Wonder Woman saves her. Then the patriarchy strikes again, and Dr. Minerva loses her cheetah powers to a man named Sebastian Ballesteros, who can...
That name's familiar.
He's the male cheetah. He's who everybody thought... Pedro Pascal was playing for a really long time before the Maxwell Lord was announced. Because Sebastian convinces the plant god Urs Kartaga that he would be a more effective host. Note, no issue of his virginity is raised. Just note that. Doesn't matter that he's not a virgin. Happily, Dr. Minerva kills Sebastian in his only storyline and offers his corpse as a sacrifice to Urs Kartaga in order to become Cheetah once more, which makes her both the third and the fifth person to be Cheetah, technically, with Sebastian being the fourth. From this point forward, Dr. Minerva's relationship with Urs Kartaga gets complicated, and he takes to punishing her from her shortcomings by doing things like leaving her human hands when the rest of her body transforms into cheetah. It's very strange.
It's very strange.
Yeah, but so basically if she does something that he doesn't like, even if he hasn't told her about it, then she gets punished, usually by not being able to fully transform or having her powers reduced in some way. As a result of their falling out over many such instances, Cheetah turns to other villains for solace and for their help. So you may remember in Flash Rogues War, when she takes up with Zoom, who teaches her how to move even faster to the point of super speed than her normal metahuman powers would have allowed. Now, Jason, you've read Rogues War literal years ago. Do you remember how she gets her super speed? It's okay if you don't.
Doesn't one of the gods give it to her?
No.
Is that right? No? Okay.
So she has to murder Priscilla Rich, who's the original cheetah that we talked about in the 10 Cent origin.
Yeah, the costume one.
Yes, as a sacrifice, basically.
All right.
So she enters into an intimate relationship with Zoom, even though Zoom is technically, his wife is dead,
He's
but he considers
married.
Himself married, yeah. And he like wears the ring and
Hunter
everything.
Zellman.
Yes. And together they join the secret society of supervillains. And then the Flash defeats them because comics. Then 1 year later happens. Jason, what is 1 year later?
1 year later is where DC pushed the entire storyline of the DC universe ahead 1 year after the big event, Infinite Crisis. It was a lot of this year was told in the awesome DC comic series 52.
There you go. Yeah, we talk about 52 a lot on this show. So during 1 year later, Cersei, who is an evil magic villain that we talked about a little bit earlier, casts a spell on Dr. Minerva, which allows her to choose when she changes between her human and her cheetah form.
Hey, there we go.
She also gets 3 cheetah pets at this time for reasons.
Are they cheetahs?
They're all cheetahs. Okay, yeah. Cool. I didn't know if they were cheetah themed pets. They're just normal cheetahs.
Different types
of
cats.
It's an ocelot, a bobcat. Yeah. No, they're just cheetahs.
And a mountain
cheetahs.
Lion, you know.
Yeah. All while retaining the super speed that Zoom has given her.
Because comics.
I personally think that she got the cheetahs because Harley Quinn has the hyenas. And that was kind of a cool visual.
Mm-hmm.
She spends a lot of this era of her life beating up on Donna Troy, I guess because she's an easier mark than Diana Prince.
I can take her.
Yeah, she's like, oh, you're an actual child. Well, by that time, she's probably an adult, but I'm going to kill you.
Yep.
And then she later goes on to make a direct attack against Wonder Woman. But in this era, it's often because she is partnered with Dr. Psycho. So Dr. Psycho's like, hey, would you
classic
go?
Wonder Woman villain.
Yes. Yep. Who I think should definitely be incorporated into the movie franchise.
That character is awesome on the Harley Quinn animated show.
There you go. But yeah, Dr. Psycho is basically like either through manipulation or the use of actual powers is like, hey, Barbara, go beat up Wonder Woman. And she's like, okay, I guess I have nothing better to do. Her next major appearance is when she teams up with Lex Luthor and the Joker. Because the thing about comics villains, not even just DC villains, is that they come and go.
Yes, they do.
As they please, because they sort of work at the whim of what the hero story demands.
Sure.
So she teams up with Lex Luthor and the Joker to form yet another newer version of the Injustice League. So they do that for a minute, and then the New 52 happens and wipes all that away. Jason, what's the New 52?
The New 52 is when DC rebooted their entire universe to say that everything only happened in the last 5 years.
Yes. So this version of Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva that we get in the New 52 is supposed to be, quote, a corrupt image and antecedent to Wonder Woman and the ideals she represents, unquote. And so in order to do that, she gets a new backstory and we get the first retcon of the episode.
Oh, really?
Can
I ask you, do I need to put an air horn on the sound effects?
No.
You sure?
No. Air horns are terrible.
Are we also going to talk about the Rebirth retcon?
Oh, yes.
Okay, cool.
We are going to talk actually a lot about Rebirth.
I didn't realize that she was retconned twice. Interesting.
The Rebirth retcon is definitely the one that affects the movie the most. So I thought it was prudent to speak about that
the
longest.
You are correct. And that's the one that most people will want to know the most about.
Yes.
What was the thing you said before? Oh, this is the first retcon?
This is the first major retcon, and this is the first retcon to her backstory. She's had minor retcons, like all comic book characters have minor retcons here and there.
Yeah.
This is the first major retcon where she gets a new alternate origin.
Yeah, so say that again. Say this is the first retcon of Cheetah?
Okay, and this is the first retcon that Cheetah gets.
All right, buckle up.
Thank you, much, Bo. So, in this continuity, in the New 52 continuity, Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva is Diana Prince's friend. I personally really like this take. I like them being friends. I think giving heroes and villains a personal connection makes much more compelling storytelling. It's the reason why I like the Superman and Lex Luthor having been friends storyline. It just gives you more stakes and more reasons to hold on. And Wonder Woman relies a lot on Dr. Minerva's knowledge of dangerous past relics that she discovers sort of on her adventures. Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva also runs a commune called Amazonia, which is a little bit on the nose, but kind of cute, I guess.
Sure.
Dr. Minerva gets her hands on a lost Amazonian dagger, which she accidentally cuts herself on, knives being knives. And this causes her to become possessed by the goddess of the hunt.
Mm.
Now, eagle-eyed scholars of Greek and Roman mythology will know that the goddess of the hunt is Athena.
I was about to say
Diana. Or Artemis, rather, or Diana, not Athena.
I was like, I don't think Diana is the goddess of the hunt. Diana becomes the goddess of war.
No. In the Roman mythology, the goddess of the hunt is Diana or Artemis.
Got it. Sorry.
So we're just sort of leaning on that. But what that really means is she becomes a human cheetah hybrid because she happened to cut her hand. In this version,
I don't hate that.
It's not bad. Well, don't get too attached to it because we're going to reboot it in about 5 years. In this version, her claws are actually pretty badass. They're kind of the coolest thing about her. There's a storyline where Cheetah scratches Superman, and this causes him to transform into another human cheetah hybrid.
I remember this.
It's cool because it makes her really, really powerful. Like, this is the most amped up, powerful cheetah that you will ever see.
If you can break the skin of Superman, that's pretty powerful.
Yeah. Also, it is incredibly stupid.
It is incredibly stupid. Superman has turned into a lion before. If you remember our episode, Superman the Silver Age.
So,
very famous cover.
I was going to say, but I'll let this pass because this is very Golden Age, very Silver Age,
very
like origin of comics. And every once in a while, because comics are so serious right now.
Yes.
I think throwing something like this in there.
I agree.
Is okay. And it doesn't last, so it's fine.
I'm going to make a note because you just share the picture of the cat-like Superman.
Please do. So eventually, of course, Cheetah's subdued because she's a bad guy, and she's tossed into the deep dark hole of the DC universe. And what would that be, Jason? Where do you think they throw her to keep her tucked away from all the good guys?
I'm going
to
guess Belle Reve.
Hey, that's a good guess.
The home of the Suicide Squad.
Yes, because the Suicide Squad movie was in development or was being planned. So DC was basically throwing all of their baddies into the clink at the time in case they wanted Amanda Waller to pick them for the movie later on. So everyone in the New 52 winds up in Belle Reve for a minute.
Yeah, they were cycling people
just
in and out.
Just in case they were like, we want you for the Suicide Squad movie.
Alfred, you want to be in the Suicide Squad?
Yeah, again, not the worst idea, but when you
Candy? Come on.
Oh, no, don't do that. That's my sweet baby angel. but when you kind of look back on this through the lens of history and knowing that the movie's coming, it's a little convenient. It's a little funny.
It was a little bit of a corporate synergy of testing out, who should be the perfect people in the movie?
Yeah, or who do we want to save for like their solo jaunts later on? So, she is there during everybody's favorite event, Forever Evil. Cheetah joins the Secret Society of Supervillains. And in a horrible sequence, Steve Trevor has a vision of Cheetah finally achieving her goal and wielding Diana's lasso. And this actually all turns out to be true. And Cheetah and Steve fight in Central Park in New York City with/over the lasso of truth together. But then once again, because patriarchy, Steve manages to overpower Cheetah, even though she is a metahuman in her cheetah form, because, quote, only Diana can use the lasso because she is truthful and pure, end quote, implying that Dr. Minerva is not truthful or pure. Now, again, I get she's a villain, but a bit heavy-handed, in my opinion.
Well, I mean, yeah, I get what you're saying.
I also think it's ridiculous that Steve Trevor, you can tell me, as capable as he is, can overcome somebody who can overcome
Superman.
Wonder
can cut
Woman.
Superman.
Yeah. So.
Yeah.
And that's her last big foray in the New 52, because then DC Rebirth happens. Jason, what's DC Rebirth?
DC Rebirth is not a reboot. But it's where like DC refocused a lot of its heroes.
Side boot.
It is a side boot. It's a soft boot.
Yeah.
Because some characters got kind of rebooted back to zero. And Wonder Woman is one of those characters, because Wonder Woman, they decided to be like, you know what? We're going to kind of like ignore most of what happened in the New 52, because for Wonder Woman in the New 52, she kissed Superman a lot, and we don't want to talk about that no more.
Yeah, they're like, look, we had like one really good run on this, and then nobody bought it anymore.
Superman is a married man, and you're going to like it.
Superman is a married man. Superman should always be married, but also,
as I've said several times,
that Superman and Wonder Woman story is good. And it makes sense to me that they would date.
I actually don't mind it. I don't mind it as experimentation, but we're talking about Cheetah.
Yes, we are. More on Superman and Wonder Woman at some point in the ambiguous future. So, creators Greg Rucka, Liam Sharp, and Nicola Scott shared responsibility for the Wonder Woman soft boot, during the DC Rebirth relaunch. It is a dueling narrative series that spins right out of Or it spins into the Liam Sharp drawn The Lies storyline. That's one storyline. And then the Nicholas Scott drawn storyline is Wonder Woman Year One.
We should talk about this because you and I love this volume quite a bit.
Mm-hmm.
And I actually think it's quite a smart thing because in Rebirth, DC Comics did this thing where they wanted to publish comic books monthly.
They shipped bi-monthly.
And Wonder Woman shipped twice a month.
Yeah.
And every month you would get an issue of
The Lies.
The Liam Sharp, The Lies, which is about Cheetah, and it was set in the present day.
Yeah.
And then you would get an issue of Nicholas Scott, and it was Wonder Woman Year One retelling her origin.
Mm-hmm. And then they sort of dovetailed and tied together thematically.
Sort of, yeah. And I liked it.
Yeah, it's really good. The Lies is definitely in the recommended reading of this episode. And The Lies storyline deals directly with Cheetah's origin, and Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva gets her retcon twice. Oh boy, I'm already sick of that.
That'll be the last time.
So I
knew we had one more reader.
Yeah. So readers learn that Dr. Minerva had been obsessed with mythology from childhood, which her family didn't like. And like, who wouldn't like that? Mythology is great. Of all the annoying things your child could be obsessed with, Greek mythology is not the worst, but she is obsessed to the point where she runs away from her family and legally changes her last name to Minerva. Now, Jason, who is Minerva?
I forget. You put me on the spot.
She's Athena, the goddess of knowledge, war, and strategy.
I knew
Roman name. It's a Latin name.
Yes, I was like, I know it's a Greek name.
She got an owl named Archimedes.
I like the Greek names better.
So do I.
Than the Roman names. I really do. That's why I don't know Minerva.
So do I.
Athena is such a cooler name.
It is an amazing name.
The only one that I like is and this is not one of the gods, so I'll accept it. I like Hercules better than Heracles.
You're crazy. Heracles sounds so badass. Dr. Barbara Ann Minerva now speaks 7 languages and has 2 PhDs. And during a dig in the Ukraine, is the first civilian in the modern world to uncover proof of the Amazons existing. And this is sort of how the story begins to dovetail with the Wonder Woman Year One storyline. Her knowledge made her an ideal candidate. As when Amazonian Princess Diana emerged, she translates for Diana because she speaks the same language as her. She helps her learn English. She acts as Wonder Woman's proxy and becomes her first friend in, quote unquote, man's world. And fun fact, Minerva is the person who teaches Diana English. I think I already said that. Dr. Minerva is saved a few times by Diana during their first few outings together, which happens when you hang around with Wonder Woman. And this kind of starts an obsession with her where she becomes fixated on all things divine. And Diana is considered divine because Diana has a patron god or goddess, depending on the storyline, who she's always working closely with. It's usually Aphrodite. She's imbued with the powers of gods through several DC reboots, which we've talked about on various other episodes. She is a demigod herself. So Dr. Minerva becomes fixated on particularly a Greek trope that the gods can come down and bless you and imbue you with their powers and stuff like that, and their knowledge. So this fixation leads her to a fake DC Comics African country called Bawunda.
What?
Bawunda.
Okay.
Where she believes...
Sounds very much like a take on Wakanda.
Yes. Where she believes Urs-Kartaga, remember him, the plant god? She believes that he's hiding out in Bawunda. So, Dr. Minerva is then tricked by Ares' son, Deimos and Phobos, into pledging herself to Urs-Kartaga and becoming a demigod herself in order to help them locate Themyscira because, just Jason mentioned... Ares earlier. Ares is always sort of a looming threat over a Wonder Woman. Always trying to find Themyscira. Always trying to mess with them nice Amazonians. Leave the nice lesbians alone. And you may remember from many of our Wonder Woman-centric episodes, that Ares hates all the Amazons with all the passion in his soul. After being transmuted into her cheetah form, Dr. Minerva blames Diana for not being there to protect her from pledging herself to Urs-Kartaga. So she's like, you weren't there. I'm mad.
But I didn't even know about it, Barbara. I had no idea.
That's kind of how the argument goes.
You literally told me nothing. You could have called on the phone, Barbara.
Yeah.
Come on.
And in this version of her, she does grapple with the same bloodlust, but she is trapped in her cheetah body. So she's, it's kind of like a vampire storyline. She's always trying to kill people.
No flip-flopping in this one, huh?
No.
Okay.
She ends up completely giving into her bloodlust at one point. She joins a group called God Watch and eats people for several years.
Ooh, yum.
Yep. It's just for a few years, years passed, and Diana's like, I wonder whatever happened to my friend. I mean, but truly. So Wonder Woman herself, like,
what happened to that cheetah lady?
Well, I don't think she knows she's cheetah. She heads to Bawunda to further investigate, where she discovers Cat Lady Cheetah, were hyenas, and an entire cult devoted to Urskartarga.
All right.
So Cheetah basically fights her immediately, sight unseen, and only stops actively trying to kill Wonder Woman when Diana admits that she hadn't been able to find her way home and she needs Dr. Minerva's help to locate Themyscira, because Wonder Woman's arc throughout the lies is she cannot get her way home. Everyone is looking for Themyscira in this arc, including Diana. Dr. Minerva agrees to help if Diana will kill Urskartarga and return Barbara her humanity, which of course Wonder Woman agrees to. It's a very noble request. Cheetah gets shamed again for not being a virgin and defeats Urskartarga using the lasso of truth. She holds the lasso and admits she's not a virgin as she defeats the plant god. And then reverting into her human form as Dr. Minerva, she helps Wonder Woman return to Themyscira and then begins dating modern day Etta Candy.
Oh, I like that.
Which I actually think is kind of cute, and I wish they'd explored that more. They don't get to live happily ever after before too long, because God Watch, remember that evil organization that she was working for a while?
Who could forget?
Yeah, I didn't remember them either. They attack Dr. Minerva until she surrenders herself to them. Now, Jason, once God Watch has their hands on her, what do you think they make her do?
Join the Suicide Squad?
Turn back into Cheetah, of course.
Ah.
Because, you know, she hasn't been Cheetah for like 3 weeks at this point. She's like a whole human again.
Uh-huh.
So she's back. She turns back into Cheetah. She don't have a girlfriend no more. Wonder Woman and Steve Trevor show up. Diana's blood is spilled to the ground and is used to open a direct gateway to Ares. They wage war against the God of War himself. Cheetah kills the woman who was the mastermind behind everything up to this point, including God Watch. And despite Dr. Minerva getting to enact a well-deserved revenge, this murder, because Diana witnesses it, ruins her relationship with Diana Prince forever, and she loses her tie to her best friend and her hero, and this person that she holds a lot of love for, because love and hate, as we all know, are opposite sides of the same. It's actually, I think, kind of sad and a touch convenient. Don't worry, though, because Lex Luthor then promptly climbs out of the woodwork and invites Cheetah to be his new best friend by joining the latest incarnation of the Legion of Doom.
Oh, thanks, Lex.
Do you know who else is on this most contemporary version of the Legion of Doom, Jason? There is four other members. Well, they're all men.
Well, actually, in the storyline, it's almost every villain in the DC universe is part of
the
Legion
of Doom.
Well, these are the main. But you're talking about the main,
yeah,
the leadership? Yeah. I think it's
four in addition to Lex.
Okay, I think it's Sinestro.
Yep.
Is it Gorilla Grodd?
Yes. It's a Batman villain and an Aquaman villain.
Black Manta.
Yep.
And then a Batman villain?
Batman villain. It's the most obvious Batman villain.
Is it Joker?
It is Joker.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
But
I know they like basically like, because they like, it's the first time that they actually did Legion as like, it's every villain.
Yes. And what is cool about it is this sort of becomes this council, right?
Yeah.
These positions of leadership. And what I think is really cool about it is they basically have one villain for every hero on the Justice, or at least the sort of reigning council of the Justice League.
Very similar to what I mentioned earlier with Grant Morrison's in Justice League, because
yes,
Grant Morrison's JLA run was the first time that we had the main heroes of all the Justice League. He also made sure that we have most of the main hero villains for all these people too.
Yeah. Do you think that we should always have a Legion of Doom or an Injustice League that has more or less a dark mirror to our Justice League lineup?
Yes and no.
Why no?
Well, because
not to get super in the weeds, but
it doesn't make sense that the villains would be
this organized.
Yes, because I will say that if you watch the Harley Quinn animated show, they have a Legion of Doom, and they play it like it is like the local Shiners Club, where Shriners Club, where it's like you have to pay your dues, and you can rent the party room, and they play it for jokes.
Yeah.
So in that show, it really works. But in thinking about it, the reality of the DC fictional universe, it's actually quite goofy.
Yes.
I'll give it to you for events, or I'll give it to you for a storyline, but the fact that like, all these people are going to join together for like years, I don't buy.
Like the Guild of Calamitous Intent?
Exactly, from Venture Brothers. I do not buy it.
Okay, that's fair.
I think these people would all attack each other.
I agree, because people who are power hungry are always still trying to find power even within their internal systems. So, working together with the Legion, Cheetah hunts down and murders Poseidon, God King of the Sea,
all right,
which earns her the moniker of God Killer. This does come after the Thor God Killer arc, for anyone keeping score at home.
I was about to ask that. Like, I was like Gore the God Killer?
Kind of.
Gore the God Killer. Sorry.
She also earns the actual mythological God Killer sword, which she then uses to go on and murder Aphrodite with. This is significant because if you remember before, I talked about how Aphrodite is most often Diana's matron goddess, the person who imbues her with her powers or gives her her guidance. So this is kind of her biggest strike against Wonder Woman to date.
Oh boy.
This is where we're going to end the lesson, because I don't want to stray too close to what is currently being published. We try to avoid spoilers. Modern but as spoiler-free as possible. And I know there are some of you at home that are saying, but you haven't talked that much about the movie. We've had so many sweet people asking us to review the movie, and Jason is going to tell you where you can actually hear us do that.
Yeah, so if you guys know, we have a Patreon, patreon.com/Jawin, J-A-W-I-I-N. And over there, we have a podcast called Geek History Lesson Extra, where usually we talk about 20 to 30 minutes more about the subject of the main episode. This week's episode is going to be a spoiler-filled review of Wonder Woman 1984. So if you want to know about Ashley and I's thoughts about Wonder Woman 84, hop on over to the Patreon, support the podcast, and join all the other super friends that help keep this podcast alive. We thank all the super friends that are over there to support us, and you get a couple other exclusive there's all kinds of stuff over there, so go check it out, patreon.com/Jawin.
Yes. Now let's move on to the recommended reading. Jason, what's that?
The recommended reading is where Professor Ashley is going to make some suggestions. If you've been interested about Cheetah, or possibly you're interested in Victor, the groundskeeper of the Themyscirian Embassy, Ashley's going to tell you three choices, maybe more, of Wonder Woman stories or Cheetah stories that you can read that'll tell you more about the character. You can find an entire list over at geekhistorylesson.com/recommended reading. Every single episode we've ever done. What's the number we're at now?
This is episode 349.
349 episodes. We have recommended reading for every single episode. You can find that at geekhistorylesson.com/recommended reading.
So the first one that I'm going to recommend is the DC Rebirth, drawn by Liam Sharp. Honestly, Wonder Woman has been very blessed to have some incredible artists working on
George Perez,
book.
Phil Jimenez.
Like Brian Bolland.
Yeah. Nicholas Scott.
Nicholas Scott, who draws maybe one of my favorite versions of Wonder Woman.
And Liam Sharp.
But Liam Sharp, I don't know if it's because
draws the best Cheetah.
He absolutely draws the best Cheetah. I don't know if it's because he is European, so he brings this very like Mobius ethereal quality to it. But like the lies is stunning. So truly, like, read it for the art, even if you don't even care about Cheetah. But Wonder Woman, The Lies. This is the most up-to-date, most modern Cheetah story. This is the volume that introduces that. It's a really good jumping on point. And this I would also recommend to people who dug the movie or dug aspects about the movie and are looking for something accessible without too much continuity. I think Wonder Woman, The Lies is the best option.
And by the way, I'm also going to say this, because I saw these recent tweets recently where Mr. Liam Sharp was accidentally left off the list, the special thanks at the very end of Wonder Woman 1984. Mm-hmm. Greg Rucka and Nicholas Scott made it on there. Liam Sharp did not. And I'm going to say to any of our listeners, Liam Sharp is the best Cheetah artist, no doubt. And one of, I would put, top five Wonder Woman artists of all time.
Yes. Yeah.
He's a great artist. Go over to his Twitter. Give him some love. Say, hey, I do think you are the best Cheetah artist, and tell them Geek History Lesson sent you.
Also, you know, when conventions start up again, if you buy a hard copy of this volume, I can't recommend getting it signed at an event enough because Liam is a lovely, lovely human.
He's
sweet,
really
sweet guy. I'm also going to recommend Justice League Volume 2, The Villain's Journey. This features her new 52 origin. So okay. If you're looking for the first big retcon, this is also probably like the hardest, most like Xbox, badass kind of version of Cheetah.
Is this the Jeff Johns run?
Yes.
Okay.
That's where you should jump in and check that out.
All right.
And then my last recommendation is going to be Wonder Woman by George Perez, Omnibus Volume 1.
Yeah.
This features her very first appearance. I know sometimes we recommend a lot of Omnibuy, and that is because we want you to get the most bang for your buck. Jason and I do a ton of reading for this. We do a ton of reading on our own. This is the only way that you can get this story right now. Is to get the omnibus, unless you're going to buy the digital single issues. But
it's like buying, it's like getting a season of television all in one shot.
Absolutely. But like, not only is this really good OG Cheetah stuff, but this is just really good Wonder Woman. Mm-hmm. We own this omnibus. Can't recommend it
enough.
We
wouldn't have the Wonder Woman movies without this run.
No, it really begins here and
yes,
moves forward. Yeah. Mm-hmm. George Perez does an awful lot for Wonder Woman. So those are my recommended reading.
Awesome.
Jason, shall we move into our discussion?
Oh, we're going to have a discussion?
We're going to have a discussion.
All right. The discussion is where we talk more about the thing we're talking about.
I want to ask you, and we kind of tied into this in the lesson, but in the pantheon of Wonder Woman villains, where would you rank Cheetah?
Ooh, you know, weirdly, I'm going to...
And I know her rogues gallery is small, and I know it is obscure, and I have just thrown this at you.
She also doesn't have a great rogues... So I'm going to do some really quick on the podcast Googling
absolutely.
Right now.
I
literally just Googled Wonder Woman villains.
Mm-hmm.
Oh boy, yeah, it is not a great list.
Because for me, the top five... And then it just goes down to preference, kind of like when we were talking about top five Wonder Woman artists. It's got to be like Ares, Cersei, Dr. Psycho.
Can I give you what Google says?
Yeah, like right absolutely.
So Google has the images with names.
Yep.
This is the order that Google gives it.
Okay.
They go Cersei,
mm-hmm.
Giganta.
No.
Cheetah.
Yeah.
Maxwell Lord.
I hate Maxwell Lord.
Dr. Psycho. The Firstborn from the Brian Azzarello.
Yeah.
Silver Swan. And then Ares.
Silver Swan. That's an interesting poll. I don't know if I put her in my top five.
You know, for me, mm-hmm. Cheetah is definitely in the top five. But I will also say this, that Cheetah is a villain that deserves a lot more stories told about her.
A lot more development.
And a lot more stories where she's just beyond like, rare, I'm a cheetah. Mm-hmm. Like I'm a human cheetah. Like that seems to be like the crux of every story. And that's why I thought the Greg Rucka, the lie story did very well.
Yeah.
Was it expanded her character? Because a lot of the stuff you kind of just told us in the lesson is very similar to that, where it's like, oh, what is that cheetah character about? Well, she's a woman that goes, rare.
Well, a thought that I had about Cheetah as I was doing research for this is, you know how every love interest in the DC character in the DC universe is just chasing Lois Lane?
Or is a Lois Lane copy, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I kind of think, because there's a lot of cat ladies.
There are.
I think a lot of female villains are chasing Catwoman.
Well, I was
you'll
say
never
this.
Be Selina Kyle.
And I will say this because I guarantee you Cheetah, the original Cheetah that was in the suit in the Golden Age, is a Catwoman copy.
Or was inspired by or whatever. And I think it's too bad because I think it's almost cliche at this point to have a DC female villain in the cat motif.
I'll be honest with you. An interesting thing to do with Cheetah would be to make Cheetah Diana's girlfriend.
I would.
Or to make Diana's ex-girlfriend.
Yes. I thought the movie was going to do that.
I thought so too.
But more on that on Geek History Lesson Extra.
You know, for me, and it's just because of the George Perez run, for me, if you were to ask me who I think Wonder Woman's greatest villain is, I do think it's Ares. I really do.
All right. Well, if people would like to request that. Wonder Woman villains.
Oh, sure.
I definitely think we're open to having a longer version of this discussion.
And I'll tell you what, if a lot of you request that,
mm-hmm.
Should it be hashtag GHL Wonder Villains?
Sure.
Or what's an easier hashtag?
Well, I think Wonder Villains works. Write that down.
Hashtag GHL Wonder Villains. If a lot of people request that, we will get a special guest. I don't know who it will be, but
maybe
you know what?
Maybe it'll be Liam Sharp.
Maybe it'll be Nicholas Scott.
Yeah.
Maybe it'll be Phil Jimenez.
Oh, yeah.
We'll try to get,
because
Phil Jimenez has a great Wonder Woman run as well. We'll try to get somebody.
We will get somebody.
We'll get somebody who's worked on Wonder Woman and get their perspective as well. Because that is an interesting conversation. And maybe it's even not a list. Maybe it's just us talking, kind of like what we're doing right now.
Yeah, that would be cool. So I think that'll wrap up our discussion. And now we're going to go right on into the honor roll. The honor roll is where if you go to Apple Podcasts and you leave us a 5-star review, we'll read whatever you want because you have helped us out in the algorithm. You've helped more cool people find us. If you are an international listener, you do have to take a screenshot and email it to geekhistorylesson@gmail.com just because we don't have access to your Apples there. But we appreciate and we love you helping spread the Mind University all over the world.
Also, you can do the hashtag GHL Wonder Villains over there, but we won't see it for a long time.
Yeah, yeah. You can also put your request there, but we're like 6 months behind.
We won't see it for a long time.
So, yes.
All right, Ashley, who's joining the honor roll? Who's the first person?
We have two people joining the honor roll today. First is Saint Mort, actual real life friend of us, Matthew Kelly, former podcast guest.
Yeah, he's been on the show.
Yes, he says, I actually care about James Bond now. He says, I was never much of a James Bond fan, but Ashley and Jason's passion has led me to actually watching and enjoying these awesome films.
Welcome to the club.
What a high compliment. Thank you. Thank you.
Where's your quick applause?
Follow St. Mort, follow Matt Kelly, and check out all of his podcasts as well. He is also joined by Mike8806, who says, thank you. I just wanted to say thank you guys for making such a great podcast about geeky and nerdy pop culture. I love that you found a way to balance between it making it highly entertaining, but also being respectful to whatever you're discussing each episode. It's rare to find on a podcast or anything, really. Keep up the great work. Mike from Pahrump, Nevada. Hey, Nevada, hope you're doing okay.
Mike, that was a very nice comment. You're welcome. Thank you so much, Mike.
Mike and Matt really raising our spirits here at the end of the Sheena episode.
And they both get to come into the Mind University Teacher's Lounge, where over in the corner, I'm going to tell you, this is a good one. Over in the corner are shortbread cookies, frosted shortbread cookies by Professor Liam Sharp. Yes, he also teaches at the Mind University. He's that awesome. And he made shortbread cookies because he teaches bread and pastry arts. So come on in there. Thank you guys for leaving us those amazing 5-star reviews. Don't forget, you can listen to this podcast and subscribe and download this podcast on Spotify. Remember, click that little follow button on Spotify, on Apple Podcasts, on Stitcher. That way you don't miss a single episode. And also, if you enjoyed the podcast, tell a friend. Tell a friend if you were like, if a friend saw Wonder Woman 1984 and they were like, I don't know anything about Cheetah, email this podcast. Put this in a podcast, in an email, excuse me. Put this podcast in an email, then put that email in a podcast. Click send, give it to your friend. All right, Ashley, if they want to suggest future lessons like the amazing people that also suggested this lesson, let's give them a final shout out. Where can they do that?
If you want to be so cool like Vicky Fox Martin, Joshua Van Dyne, I made you a drag queen, and Tom Hibbert, you can do that by going to geekhistorylesson.com, facebook.com/geekhistorylesson, or hit us up on Twitter at GHL Podcast. Don't forget, hashtag GHL Wonder Villains.
Hashtag GHL Wonder Villains.
Yes, because we want to see those requests.
Don't forget, you can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at Jawin. That's J-A-W-I-I-N. That's where you can find all the notifications about my upcoming Kickstarter, Super Best Friend.
Heck yeah.
And you can also find Ashley on Instagram and Twitter. Ashley's taking a lot of pictures of her standing by the beach at Ashley V. Robinson. And don't forget, over at patreon.com/Jawin, if you want to support the show and get more Geek History Lesson related content, our Wonder Woman 1984 review will be over there.
Woo!
This week. Like pretty close to when this episode drops. That episode's going to be up on Patreon. So you can literally hop from here to there in your invisible jet. Oh boy.
I mean, literally, if you are getting this on the main feed rather than early for being a patron, literally the same day this drops, a couple hours in the future.
Yes, but enough of that. Now is the last section. Hashtag stick around, where we talk after the plugs because we wanted to see if you stuck through the plugs because we have a little bit more show.
Yeah.
Ashley, what's our hashtag stick around?
So in the hashtag stick around, I want to ask you the eternal question that I always push against. Do you think Cheetah is a villain or an anti-hero?
Villain.
Yeah? You don't think she's good enough, pure enough, spirit?
I don't think there has been a story that has proven to me that she's an anti-hero.
Would you be interested in that type of storyline?
Yes, very much so. I like I said to you, I think they're hearing her history, mm-hmm. complete history, and it's the most I've ever heard it in my entire life just now. I think there is. Now, the problem is that this would require another retcon, but there is some sort of storyline to where, like, I kind of think Wonder Woman and Barbara are girlfriends, and then there's some sort of lover spat, and then Barbara becomes Cheetah because of it.
I think this would be a great type of story to, because I'm definitely a believer in, like, it all happened, it's all one continuity,
and that sort
of Grant Morrison school of thought.
Your own continuity?
I think a great place for that would be in the, like, Wonder Woman Earth 1 continuity.
Yeah.
To see something like that.
We're getting that Volume 3 very soon.
Yes. Also by Grant Morrison.
Do you think she's an anti-hero?
No, I don't.
Okay.
But I do see a lot.
Well, you're the one posing the questions. That's why.
But I read a lot of opinions on Cheetah, and I read
People think she's an anti-hero.
I read a lot of message boards and stuff like that.
Oh,
and
boy.
A lot of there is, like, definitely a Cheetah, Barbara Minerva specifically, like, group of hardcore fans. And a lot of it, a reason that people go to anti-hero, because she doesn't behave like, when you think of an anti-hero, right, like Harley Quinn is sort of the easiest catch-all, or Red Hood maybe.
Yeah.
She's not selfless in her actions, but I think what they're driving more for is, like, she has a tragic story. Like, she wanted to be friends with women. She wanted to study Wonder Woman. Like, she fell from grace doing aspirational things.
Sure.
And I think we just don't have a great word for that, because that's just a villain term, right? That's just the tragedy of hubris in the sort of King Lear way of looking at it.
Oh, look at you using that English degree.
Thank you. I learned that word in high school a public school.
Yes, Ashley is way smarter than I am. It's fine. I would love to see that story. I don't believe that story in the current Cheetah Tales exists.
I think that is fair.
She's pure villain to me.
I think that's where we'll wrap this up.
Yeah, I think it's a good place to wrap
it
up. I think it's a good place to tie a lasso around it.
Hey. Lasso of
Hestia. Because if you're catching cheetahs, that's all you can do.
Oh, no, don't catch cheetahs. Leave them alone.
Yeah, leave the cheetahs alone.
I think they're endangered.
Are they?
I don't know.
Cheetahs are my...
Leave the cheetahs alone!
I didn't say this during any of the rest of the podcast, but cheetahs are my favorite animal.
Yes, I knew that.
Yeah, I love the cheetahs. Anyways, thank you so much for listening to Geek History Lesson.
They're vulnerable. They're not endangered.
Oh. Well, I am Jason. Leave the cheetahs alone, Inman.
I am Ashley Victoria Robinson.
And Professor Ashley, will you please close out this feline fantastic episode?
Class is now meow.
Meow. Oh, boy.